morning, John. How you doing, brother? I got the prophecy cat here if you have any questions or comments. Here, I'll raise him up. There you go. Hey, Gub. Good morning, man. Good morning, Lua. Excellent, John. Good. Glad to hear that. I just thought I'd come on and let everybody see me torturing this poor cat. Look at the fear in his eyes. He's paralyzed. You doing okay, Lua? Cat, are you? Yeah, he's horrified, John. I think he's too tired to scream and climb the walls in horror and terror. But yeah, he's got it real rough. He just took a nap, and then he gets up from the nap and decides he wants to help me, and so we come online, because he's not good for much. He can't pull a plow, not even if I use a whip. I hear you, Lua. It's coming. You know, that's one of the few things that we can be confident in this world, are the promises in Scripture. And Jesus is coming. Ain't that right? If Jesus is coming, don't say anything. See? He's using his claws to raise up on. That's my knee, brother. Most cats won't allow that. Well, the one thing he don't like is if I mess with his back feet. Watch this. He's too tired to fool with me today. Poor kitty. Daddy just tortures it. Amen, John. Hey, Harley, how you doing? Welcome to public cat torture. He's so tired of the torture, I don't even have to restrain him anymore. He's too tired to move. Cat violence. I'm clutching his head like a baseball. He don't care. He's decided that I'm his human. He don't mess with other people either. He won't go to Miss Breeze. He don't trust her. What's going on with you guys? Lua, I think you were on TNS last night. I, just as he was going off, he was talking about some Israeli airstrikes against Hezbollah or in Lebanese airspace, and you know, it's not real sure which. What are you doing, brother? No. But I know that Iran was trying to ship a bunch of drones to Hezbollah so they could use them to strike Israel, you know, because they're pretty upset with Israel. And, well, like I said, the implications and how they relate to the Bible are pretty broad. Hey, Dale, how you doing, man? Poor kitty. Big old warm lap to lay on. Life's hard, ain't it? Angry cat. Surprised cat. Surprised cat. Aerodynamic cat. Hey, Bill, how you doing, brother? Something needs your attention behind that water heater. Well, I'm glad you're hanging in there, Bill. God bless you, brother. We're all pulling for you. Hey, Bob, good morning, man. Yeah, I'm going to improve your cat view a little bit. I think he's been fighting or something. He's got a bald spot on his foot here. Here, let me show him. He don't want to show it right now. And I got cat hair floating around my face or something that makes my beard itch. I hadn't heard anything about a radiation leak as yet, Lua. But too, you know, I'm not really focused on that region of the world as much. Three days ago. Yeah, it's interesting, Lua. Thanks for letting us know. I'll be on the lookout for that now. Or any development in that area. Unsmoke the kitty. What? Oh, it's a Swisher Sweet. He asked me what kind of cigar we were smoking. Well, Harley, isn't just about anything that leaks down eventually going to become cesium? I'm not sure now. I'm not a radio tech, but I know cesium-237 in groundwater is definitely a bad mix. What time is the eclipse tomorrow, guys? I'm thinking that the midst of it is just before 3 p.m., but I haven't checked. Does anybody know? Is that correct? Hi, Dawn. How you doing? I can barely see the chat from here. If I lean forward, then I dump Goober Kitty in the floor. Okay, Bob. Hey, Sue. Good to see you. Australia. What time is it, Dawn? I'm guessing, let's see, you're about 12 hours, 7 p.m. there, at a guess. What are you doing? You want to go outside? Have you not got any news for us? Tell me. I'll pull your foot. I'll pull your foot. Let everybody see how mean you are. I'll get your foot. I'm getting your feet. Ow, you're digging your claws in my knee. Usually he'll grab my hand and try to bite at me when I pull at his feet. I got your foot. Ow. It's a cat foot. See? Ah. Okay, I'll quit before you bite me. Here, let's get down. Look, I'm trying to pour him out. He don't want to go. Come on. There you go. Here, come on. Look, I'll take you outside in just a second. Let me catch up here. I couldn't see it all. Yeah, I'm not going to get a great view of it, Dawn. I'm in Georgia. I mean, it's I've experienced them before to that effect. It'll be just kind of dim and odd looking in the middle of the day. Tater here? Hey, Tater. Good to see you, brother. Hope you're feeling better too, Tater. I'm pulling for you and Bill both a lot. All right, there's a lull in the conversation. I'm going to put the cat out right quick because he's probably about ready to find somewhere to leave me a prize. Yeah, I've heard a lot of people say things like that, Dawn. We'll talk about that in just a moment as soon as I get back. Stand by. Just did one of my own pet peeves, if you will. I put my coffee in the microwave and hit the button and didn't look, and there was like 2 seconds left on the clock, and so by the time I turned to walk away from it, it was stopping. And I'm like, good morning. Let's see here. Oh yeah, Dawn said, she said, I've heard some people say the rapture could happen during the eclipse. Well, Dawn, you know, in a sense, that's 100% true, because the rapture could happen at literally any moment. And so, yeah, it could happen during the eclipse. I'm not that there isn't any, and not that, that there are any regulations on God or His will. But we don't find any real biblical precedents that would suggest that something might happen during the eclipse. There are a few mentions of the sun turning dark in Scripture. unfortunately, one of the ones that I keep hearing brought up is 3 days of darkness. And the only place that really occurs biblically is in Exodus, when God cast darkness over Egypt for 3 days. But what history and extra biblical sources tell us is that the Assyrians at Nineveh had gone through some other calamities that caused them to pay more heed to Jonah, whom they hated, and he hated them in return. Part of that was, or one of the last things before he showed up, is an eclipse. But we also know that, you know, his prophecy against Nineveh was, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And so, you know, that would suggest that, you know, a period of at least 40 days, possibly 50 days, elapsed between the eclipse and what would have been God's proclamation of judgment. But at any rate, you know, we're not in any position to foretell anything, or even make good guesses. I would say best thing to do is, you know, go with what we know from Scripture and hang on and watch. Let's see, have I missed anyone? I see Brother Ken. How you doing, Ken? Who's John Paulson? I don't know, man. He just showed up here, and he's sort of like my cats. You know, I fed him, and he stays. Hey, Vicky, how are you? Good morning. Yeah, also, Bill, I wish Brother John was here. Being John, he made a video, and Mark on TNS talked about it a little bit last night, but surprisingly, not that many people were talking about it. The path of the eclipse practically traces the New Madrid fault line, and that's a good catch on John's part. Because, like I said, I haven't seen many or anybody talking about it other than him, and I kind of think he's the one that alerted Mark to it. But very interesting. And I mean, you know, too, we know that for example, the moon's gravitational influence affects the tides here on Earth. And gravity is a very weak force among forces, but we do know that, like I said, the moon's influence has an effect on our tides, and if just the moon's influence has an effect on our tide, I wonder what's possible with everything lined up, and like I said, kind of seemingly pointed at that fault line. I'm not, certainly not predicting anything, and I really don't expect anything, but it's all quite interesting. Yeah, Bob, I wish I could gain some weight, brother, but, you know, I hardly ask what kind of things could cause 3 days of darkness. Astronomically speaking, I have no clue of anything that could do that, Harley. Once it was said that a massive planet passing between the Earth and the Sun might obscure the sun for a period of time such as that, but you know, I can't see a planet that massive coming that close to Earth without that being the least of our worries. And so, like I said, you know, astronomically speaking, I don't know of anything, but you know, I'm certainly not the authority on the subject, but yeah, I don't know. Yeah, God can do it. I'm firmly on Ken's side on that. I don't eat any pork, Harley. But two, you know, like I said, I wish I could gain weight, but you know, it's just doesn't seem to be in the cards. And you know, I'm not about preserving the flesh, guys. I'm about going home, and where I'm going, I don't need this meat. Where I hope to go, I don't need this meat. I ain't about to. It'd have to be pretty dense, Harley, you know, to completely obscure the sun, because that junker's pretty bright. But, you know, yeah, something of that nature. But, you know, two, we don't really have any clouds of dirt floating around. You know, the debris we have seems to be in the, was it Kuiper Belt? Where all the rocks and debris are floating around. There you go, Ken's doing taking care of my half. I hear you, Bill. I ain't got no luggage.
I ain't got no luggage. I'm just standing over waiting.
You nailed it, Lua. That's Polaris. Polaris is at the virtual center of our. It's almost perfectly due north if you look at the star map as a globe for us, and so that's where I calculate my calibrate my motor drive. On Polaris, because that only puts you like a half degree off. Saving all the kittens. I'm afraid I'm fixing to have a fresh wave of kittens, Bill. So come on over and I'll hook you up. I got enough already. That youngest little orange cat, I don't know if he was ever on live stream or not, but he passed away. He always had something kind of wrong with him. And, wasn't exactly sure what it was. And against all odds, he kept pulling through, but I found him. He looked like he'd been injured. I don't know exactly what the deal was, but they come and go. We've had lots and lots of barn cats. North or northeast Poland? I'll try to make a mental note of that there, Lua. And I just don't know. Like I said, I meant to mention Isaiah 17 yesterday. On the stream and neglected to do so, but that was kind of in regards to this big giant drone shipment that Iran was trying to get over there, and it was going to pass through Damascus, and in a sense it's kind of a big deal, so I wondered what might happen in regards to Isaiah chapter 17. Take care, Harley. Be careful. Take care, John. We'll see you, brother. I can't stay too terribly long today anyway. My mother's got a Hyundai and her passenger side window is down and will not up. And so I'm going to have to regulate a window regulator. Hey, Bun Bun. Good to see you, brother. I've looked at the way those things are built, and I just absolutely hate it. You know, on American cars for years and years, the window regulator's a steel, stamped steel mechanism that it resembles a cross between a pair of scissors and a bumper jack or a jack. Screwjack, and the mechanism on that Hyundai is a stamped out plastic tray with some cable or strings and pulleys on it. It looks disposable, but I expect it's disposable for a couple hundred bucks. Yeah, I would, Bill, but since it's my mother's car, I'm going to have to kind of fix it and make it look right. You know what I mean? Oh, you can make fun of me if you want to, Bob. Gosh, it wouldn't be the first time. John, Bob, I couldn't, what were you been, brother? there ain't enough of me left. I might drag myself through the airspace you once occupied. That'd be about it. I wouldn't want to be the poor dude that kicked in my door, because I can still shoot, but fight? No way. It'd have to be over in about 10 seconds or I'd be gassed. There you go, Ken. Bob, you may be behind, brother. Let me put it in the chat. I hate when that happens. Don't click on the line. Yeah, I'm familiar with the way it's built and all that stuff, Harley, but it's going to be a pain in the butt because it's got so many, you know, there's screws all the way around that big tray regulator, and it's made out of plastic, so there's no telling what's broken in there. And I don't think she wants to fix it if it's broken. She probably wants me to just prop the window up and leave it up. I don't know. We'll see. It's likely I can fix it either way, even if it's broken, but I just hate to fool with that thing. Did Bob catch up with us? If you get behind, you can click the where it says live in the bottom of your video, and it should bring you up to speed. Where the little word live is. Everybody quit talking. Where'd y'all go? Somebody get me a mustard and biscuit. Thank you, Bill. I needed some orientation. Well, the video of me, Bob. Trying to remember lines from the movie, Bill, and I can't remember the setup to it, but you know, remember when he was telling his story to the girl about whacking Jesse with the sling blade? And he said his mama, "What'd you kill Jesse for? What'd you kill Jesse for?"
I reckon I shouldn't have done that.
What did the Papa Tomato say to the baby tomato crossing the road? You got me, Ken. Yeah, you go. Catch up.
I reckon catch up had to be it.
That's what we would call grown-worthy. Good morning, Pamela. How are you? Hey, Paula, how are you? Because they got big fingers, Bill. I know that one. Yeah, I think you told me that one, Bill. I'm trying to think if I know any good ones. Any good ones that I can tell. It's good to see you, Pamela. I'm hanging in there, Paula. How about yourself? What time you got there, Paula? About 1 p.m., 1:50, no, 1:30-ish. Blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand. A day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong. There hath not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. The land is as the Garden of Eden before them, and behind them a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. The appearance of them is as the appearance of horses, and as horsemen so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on tops of mountains shall they leap, like the noise of flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array. Before their face the people shall be much pained, all faces shall gather blackness. They shall run like mighty men, they shall climb the walls like men of war, and they shall march every one on his ways, and they shall not break their ranks. Neither shall one thrust another, they shall walk every one in his path, and when they fall upon the sword they shall not be wounded. They shall run to and fro in the city, they shall run upon the wall, they shall climb up upon the houses. They shall enter in at the windows like a thief. The earth shall quake before them, the heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great, for he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible, and who can abide it? Therefore also now, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. And rend your heart, and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent, and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God? Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thine heritage to reproach. That the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? What then will the Lord be jealous for his land? Pity his people. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith, and I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. But I will remove far off from you the northern army, and will drive him into a land barren and desolate, with his face toward the east sea, and his hinder part toward the utmost sea, and his stink shall come up, and his ill savor shall come up, because he hath done great things. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. First month begins tomorrow or tomorrow night, what about that? And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Amen. Amen. Anybody know what passage I just read? There you go, Bob. Let's see here. I'm behind. I see Bill throwing food everywhere. Oh, come on, scroller. Awesome, Paula. I'm glad you had a good prayer time. Oh, stop that. Bill, when you get done in the kitchen, just throw all the dishes and the pots and pans away, man. I'm not cleaning that mess up. Yeah, Vicky, you're talking about the cicadas. Hey, David. And two, you know, they act like they're making a bigger deal out of that than it is. The cicadas, they do have a long dormancy underground, but we have cicadas every year. But it's just that I think whether it be different varieties or what, sort of like waves, every now and then you get some bigger ones, and I think that what we're going to have is a hatch of several varieties that coincide and a big mess of them, but nevertheless it certainly could be a prophetic type thing. I have considered that. Goober was on a little earlier, David. Yeah, I haven't made any muffins in a while, Pamela. I need to consider making some muffins. Yeah, we're talking about Joel chapter 2. That's what I read, guys. It's Joel chapter 2, I think. Most, if not all, y'all probably recognized it. It's often referred to in this context, and You know, I don't think I want to try no cicada biscuit there, Bob. Have you ever seen a cicada? They look sort of like a giant housefly to me, and they can make a bunch of noise when they fly around, and we used to kind of catch them and bring them in the house. When I was young, I don't know, but under 30 and still single, I lived here in this house with my big brother and a mutual friend of ours, and there was almost always people here, and a lot of them were girls, and anyway, we'd catch a cicada and bring it in and tell the girls it was poisonous, and you know, those things just make all kind of noise flying around, and the girls be screaming and running, and you know. But too, I mentioned to somebody, cicadas are a favored food of copperhead snakes. I want to say rattlesnakes. They're related to rattlesnakes, but they're not technically a rattlesnake. But yeah, you know, you'll find those of you that are from this part of the world, you'll find where they morph, you'll find their empty shells clinging on the side of like cedar trees and stuff like that. And you have to watch out in those places because copperheads like to hide and they like to eat cicadas. And so if you find yourself somewhere where cicadas will congregate, such as on a cedar tree, watch your feet. Oh yeah, we used to use crickets a lot. And I tell you, the most effective brim bait I have ever used, Vicky, is wasp or hornet larvae. The old men used to rob wasp and hornet's nests, and you take the larvae out of those little chambers and put that on a fish hook, and you're going to catch a fish. Yeah, they're meaty looking, ain't they, Bob? We did that too, Gabrielle, but we did that with what we call June bugs. It's a Japanese beetle species, and they're kind of iridescent, greeny brown, sort of like motor oil in color. They're shiny on their back. We'd tie threads to those and fly them in circles, and yeah, they'll make a buzzing noise. But a cicada, he makes a squealing, chirping noise. They're really loud. Yeah, like I said, be careful, Vicky. Like, copperheads like to hide. I would say that you're probably more likely to be bitten by a copperhead than most any other kind of pit viper. I know several people that have been bitten by snakes, and all of them were bitten by copperheads. And it's because copperheads are so shy, they like to hide. And occasionally people will invade that hiding territory, and it don't go well. But yeah, they'll light you up, and they're timid and hidey. And you know, copperheads, I don't know if you know or realize, but they don't get very big either. The biggest one I think I've ever seen is about 3 feet long. But yeah, they'll light you up. They'll give you inoculation, as the old folks would call it. Good morning, Digna. Good to see you, sis. So now we're having rattlesnake chat and coffee. Y'all tell me what's interesting, because I know there's a lot of news that I have missed. Amen, Gabrielle. I hope they were all listening. Guys, we just read Joel chapter 2, considering its relevance to the days. I just considered another passage that we might want to take a short look at. And we'll do that too. Scripture reading never hurt anybody, eh? And y'all tell me what passage this is. I think you'll all recognize it as well. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given great power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And guys, remember, they just called them locusts, but it says that they were commanded not to eat or hurt any green thing, and that's what locusts eat. So what kind of locusts are we dealing with here? Excuse me. It was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months, and their torment was as the torment of a scorpion, and he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000,000, and I heard the number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire and of jacinth and brimstone, and the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions, and out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. By these three was the third part of men killed by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouths. For their power is in their mouth and in their tails, for their tails were like unto serpents, and had heads, and with them they do hurt. And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. Amen. What passage was that? I know y'all know. You know, Vicky, I've got to find out about Brother Bill Cloud. I've been familiar with him for a number of years. I mentioned it, I think, some time ago that I grew up around a family whose last name was Cloud, and one of the boys' name was Bill. The one closest to my age, his name was David. I've often wondered if it's the same guy. And we were all kind of young, preteens, so it may be hard to recognize him. When I look at him, I don't recognize him, so it's probably a different Bill Cloud, but I suppose it could be the same one. And I scroll my chat back, and it pauses if you leave it there. Yeah, that's 9, Vicky, that's right. And the reason I read that, guys, you know, is in relation to the Large Hadron Collider. Everybody calls it CERN, but CERN is the governing body of people that manage and run the machine. CERN stands for literally Center European Research Nuclear, the machine itself is the Large Hadron Collider, or the LHC. But you know, everybody's talking about the eclipse and them going up to unprecedented power levels with the collider and stuff like that. I've long correlated the passage we just read, Revelation 9, with the collider because of where it's built. You know, they say that the scripture tells us the angel of the bottomless pit is Apollyon, and that thing is basically built right around the gates of Apollo. Physically, I mean, it's right there in the middle of it, the gates of Apollo. And we've all seen all the satanic imagery and stuff that's associated with it, and the statue of Shiva out front, all that sort of stuff. And so it's real easy for my mind to settle on a correlation between those two. Hey, Dean, good morning, brother. And two, like I said, Vicky, you know, that's the Hebrew year begins with the new moon of Nisan, which should occur very soon. I think if I'm not mistaken, it's tonight or the following day. But yeah, all of it's a convergence: the Hebrew New Year, the eclipse, the Large Hadron business, just all kind of stuff going on. Well, you know, Vicky, I find it very interesting too that, you know, of the literal thousands of Hindu deities, they chose Shiva. I mean, I know it was, I think it was given, donated to them as a gift or whatever, but you know, it turns out that it's Shiva, and you know, Shiva is the destroyer creator, or destroyer slash creator, and destroyer of worlds and recreates worlds, and all that's pretty suspect too, if you will. Amen, Dean. I hope that for everyone, God's peace, especially in these times. I know that a lot of people feel threatened and frightened, and just give up your worries and don't worry about this plane of existence, because it is temporary. Well, actually, Vicky, check it out. Shiva is neither male nor female. I think Shiva is both. Yeah, Shiva's a demon. Yes, Dane, that's correct. And of course, we all, what year was it that they opened that Gotthard tunnel there in Sweden or Switzerland? At any rate, all that imagery, you know, just purely satanic. I think, Vicky, and I'm no expert on Hinduism. I know very little about our scriptures and stuff, and try to focus on that. But I think that Shiva is considered both rather than neither. I think that Shiva is considered to be both. But again, I'm certainly no authority on Hinduism. Oh, yeah, Bill. And you know, have you seen, I know y'all have noticed how exponentially worse it's getting. It's just wow. And if you've ever watched any of these police videos, police body cams and stuff, the ideas and the things that people say disturb me as much as anything. It's hard to think of a good situation. a fugitive. A lady had been a fugitive for years, and they finally caught on to her and caught her. And her reasoning was that, well, I've been here for 3 or 4 years, and I've been good. I hadn't done nothing wrong, so y'all need to leave me alone. Let me be. And you know, she was without doubt guilty of a serious crime some years before that. But her assertion was that, no, well, I'm good now. So, you know, as if she could absolve herself of any guilt. And that's a problem that the world embraces. Careful reading, careful study of Scripture explains to us how we have all fallen short of the glory of God. You know, it may not be our fault as individuals that you know, the fall of man happened and then all the corrupt and evil influence came in. But, you know, by way of just growing up in it and not being able to or rejoining that perfect path, you know, caused us to grow up in sin. And, you know, that's what God talks about when he says the sins of the fathers will be visited upon the children, you know, and the children's children. And that's really what he's talking about is that, you know, it's more or less learned behavior. But, you know, that's what the fallen angels did. They came and they taught mankind this stuff. And, you know, I guess it's difficult to unlearn. All right, let me back up here. Yeah, we mentioned that just a minute ago, Dean. You know, and like I said, it's a significant event, but I wouldn't put too much into it. You know, it happens every so often like this, and it's because there's like different varieties of them and different breeding cycles. For example, if you look at fireflies, this is amazing in God's work, guys. There's like 4,700 varieties of them, and they never interbreed, and they only identify each other by the color and frequency of that light, and that's just astounding. But my point is the cicadas are kind of the same way. There's lots of different varieties of them, and they have different dormancy periods. Their eggs or larvae or whatever is deposited subterraneously or underground, and they remain there and develop, and then they hatch out. We have them every year, but some years we'll have a bigger hatch, and I can't remember how, but it's predictable to science, and what we have is a lot of big hatches coming together at once this year. And it does happen from time to time. I want to say every 40 or 50 years, something like that. But too, you know, its timing is certainly significant. Did we just hear that? What did you hear, David? I hope it wasn't a trumpet and he don't answer. No, okay, David. Yeah, that's disgusting, brother. No, I'm just kidding. Roll down the window. Muchica pesta, man. Hey, alien believers. Since 1840, Dean, that's interesting. But, you know, again, the cycles happen. And so I just try not to get too excited about stuff like that. You know what I mean? Certainly, like I said, it's very interesting. And we watch all these things, you know, as situational awareness, I guess you might say. And, yeah, good morning, alien believers. Thanks for dropping in. What follows the opening of the pit, Dean, is it says that, you know, the those locusts emerge from the smoke of the pit and torment men for 5 months. I don't know, but I would expect that George would probably be out of here by the at that point. And so, you know, that gives us reason to consider that it may be very, very, very soon. Right, like I said, it says smoke comes out of the pit, and then these locusts come out of the smoke. Believers, do I know you under another name? That name, I can't remember if I've seen you here or not before, but welcome and thanks for joining us. We're glad to have you. Yeah, there's, you know, like I said, that's very compelling that there is a literal place on the map that is the gates of Apollo. And yeah, it's, guess where you'll find it? Google Earth. You'll be right in the middle of the Large Hadron Collider. Well, we're glad to have you, alien believers. And if you've been with us before and I'm just not recalling your name, I'll probably remember it this time. And thanks for coming. Good morning, Sue Ellen. How are you? My bad, alien believers. It's difficult to keep up with everyone. Please forgive me on that in that regard. And again, re-welcome and thanks for coming. And I'll do better about recognizing you in the future. My apologies. Yeah, well, like I said, you know, I like that my channel is small and I'm able to maintain a personal relationship with folks and you know and remember things about you guys and stuff. And I feel guilty that you've been coming and I don't know you any better. And I apologize for that. And you know, hey, I'm always here for you guys. And you know, my email's common knowledge to everyone. I'll post it in the chat again. But I'm happy to interact with you guys, and again, I appreciate you. Mom wants to go back to the Pacific Northeast. All right, then. I don't think I'd want to be there, Sue Ellen, but I've never lived there, so I don't know. I was stationed and lived near where Helen Gayle Townsend lives. She lives in Rapid City, South Dakota, and I was stationed at Ellsworth Air Force Base just outside Rapid City for some time, and I like that part of the country, but I never got as far west as you are or you're talking about. You know, Paula, I mentioned the Houthis. I think it was in a chat with that chat that David invited me to last night or yesterday evening, the one I had to duck out of and go to bed. But man, I keep saying the history books are going to write about the Houthis in past tense. There's not that many of them. They're making way too much trouble and they're going to get themselves extincted. I know that ain't a word, but I like saying it that way. Yeah, Rapid City, David. Like, you know, a river with rapids in it. Look, you made me say rabid, boy. 20 years. Now, Alaska interests me, Sue, but I haven't been there. But yeah, I'm a country boy. I like people, but I don't want to have close neighbors. Yeah, I hear you, sis. what I've seen of it, it's beautiful. And like I said, I'd like to go there. But too, you know, I know a lot of people, they think, oh, I want to live in Alaska, and they move up there and they find out, uh-oh, I've bitten off more than I can chew. They're no match for even the UK alone, Paula. Like I said, I would say, and too, guys, you know, I don't study this stuff and stay up to date on it. I know some people and, you know, have some pretty good information, but the Houthis, I would put their numbers, their strongest numbers, between 50 and 70,000. And, you know, that's a lot of people. But as a military force, it ain't much, especially when you're fighting with bows and arrows. Now, they've got some advanced weapons they're getting from Iran and stuff, but they're not up to it. Like I said, Great Britain alone could go over there and stomp a new mud hole in their backsides, and they're going to get extinct. Well, I'm kind of jealous, Dale. I sure would like to see Alaska. Like I said, I haven't been there. Well, alien believers, I'm with you, brother, and I'll soon turn 60 myself. I'm used to thinking that I am 60 because Miss Breeze always rounds my age up, and so she tells people I'm 60. You know, one of my favorite old shows, gosh, I started to say from the 80s, but I'm not sure if it's 80s or 90s, guys. Y'all can set me straight on it. Northern Exposure. But the fact is that was filmed in Washington, a great deal of it, not Alaska. But I love that show and that little idea of that town and stuff. What was it, Sicily, Alaska, supposed to be and stuff? And yeah, I always liked that. Yeah, Dale, that's another thing, too, is how the sun just kind of doesn't go down. Oh, my birthday's not until August, Vicky. It's interesting, Paula. My dad had a place in Florida up until a year or so ago, and he sold it. I don't know, Dean. Turning 40, 50, all that, it wasn't really rough, but I could tell when I started getting old. That happened at 48. That was when I first looked down at my phone to see what time it was, and the letters and numbers were fuzzy. And I had always had exceptional vision. I mean, literally better than 20/20. And then one day, like I said, I looked at my phone and I'm like, hey, what's going on here? And it's been downhill since then. Didn't like the camera deal. I'm a little bit lost. You mean how you looked as you got older? I'm not sure what you mean about 48 or 1848, yeah, one of the two. But you know, it's funny, I literally remember I had my phone on my belt, and I could just kind of, it was on a swivel thing, and I could turn it up facing me and open it and see the time. And I was out in my garden, and that was the year before Miss Breeze and I bought 300 or 400 feet of garden hose so we could water the garden without carrying the water. I used to carry 5-gallon buckets of water out there, and that's what I was talking about getting old. At the time I was 48, and I would carry 6 buckets of water at one time. They weren't full, of course, because you splash it all out, but 3.5-4 gallons per bucket, and I'd carry them couple hundred yards, and that's a lot of poundage of water, and I can't get close to working like that anymore. Oh yeah, I got you, Dean. Yeah, I can understand that too, brother. Better than sending in a sketch artist. You know, I'll have to agree with David too. All right, I'm going to make y'all's brains itch because I know y'all have done the same thing. If you guys wondered about life in the millennium, or you know, we know that Christ is going to reign over the earth for 1,000 years. And have you considered that? Have you wondered, you know, what will be our places and, you know, what will we do and stuff like that? You know, I have all kinds of wonders, you know, about, for example, you know, I expect us to be gone for a period of around 7 years. And, you know, I probably couldn't leave my house today for a month without something bad happening here. And so I can't imagine being gone for 7 years and it still being intact when we come back, and things like that. Like I said, I wonder about them, but I don't worry about them. But it's kind of fun and interesting. Maybe you can encourage yourselves a little bit with such, I wanted to say frivolous thoughts, but you know, it's just kind of interesting. You going to an oil platform in the Gulf? Well, you be careful, Lua. I've thought about those things before, and I would not want to work on one. I mean, I'm a great swimmer and all that sort of stuff, but it just doesn't interest me much. Good luck. God bless you. Concerned about my, I can't see for that silly little heart there, Sue Ellen. When it scrolls up, I'll read the rest of your comment. I wish YouTube had moved that thing. I did something the other day and accidentally made it disappear. I wish I could do it again. Engage with your audience. What's that all about? Concerned about your dog. I got you. Well, you know, we know that God is merciful and just, and I'm sure that He has a plan. And I just trust Him with everything, Sue. And I think your dog, your puppy, will be all right one way or the other. Yeah, that's what Lua was talking about there, alien believer. I'm fixing to click on a button, guys, that says engage with my audience. And I'm going to see what it does because I have no idea. Okay, start a Q&A, start a poll. Yeah. Amen, Dean. No more tears. Well, Sue, you know, we don't know. Maybe they'll go too. You know, this is going to be our first time. So, you know, I don't really think anybody knows exactly what to expect. And, yeah, you know, and too, you know, again, with those crazy thoughts and stuff, you know, I wonder about all the pets and stuff I've had over the years and things like that. And so, you know, I don't know. But I know that God is just and merciful and loving and kind and His mercy endureth forever. And so we don't have anything to worry about. Hey, Jess, good to see you. Well, we're glad that you joined us. Yeah, don't worry. Just like I said, implicitly trust God. We won't have anything to worry about. Well, somebody asked me about that. Might have been Paula yesterday or sometime, alien believers. And, you know, they said that somebody told them that pets didn't have souls and they wouldn't be in heaven and all. But, you know, there are points for arguments on both sides of that. But Scripture does indeed say that God is able to save man and the beast. And so anybody that claims they know is making up stuff. Amen. I'm still trying to find the coffee pot. David, we can get you one of them locators, like for losing, for finding lost keys, where you mash a button and it makes a beeping noise. But then I guess you'd be hunting for the button to mash, right? What is it with these flame-proof cigars? I think they're made of asbestos. Used it to add some water to the fish tank. That'll work. Let's see. Get eclipse. And eclipse in itself is a big subject. You know, a lot of interesting little things about it. But, you know, I certainly don't have any predictions. I'm just going to watch and see what happens. What do you guys think? What do y'all think is going to happen? I know a lot of people have a lot of different ideas. And anything could happen. I don't know. I'm afraid that folks that are expecting some great thing to be disappointed, but we'll watch and see. That'll be a good place to see it, Alien. At least you'll probably be up around all the low-level obstructions. Yeah, that's the live stream I was talking about, Vicky. I popped in there for a little bit last night, but I didn't see anything get crazy in there. I had to go to bed early last night, and I popped on out a little while after I got there. You know, Dean, something you probably know already, but I find it rather interesting that in the known universe, and you know that limits it a great deal right there. But in the known universe, we are the only place that experiences eclipses like we do. I find it very interesting what God says there in Genesis. He says that they're for signs and seasons. And then, if we closer examine that aspect, we find that the sun is 400 times bigger than the moon, but it's also 400 times further away than the moon. And so when we look up, we see them as the same size. And because of that spacing, you know, we're able to have the eclipses like we do. From our perspective, the moon is big enough to occlude the sun. And then furthering that even more is that number 400, you know, we see it firmly established there. Well, then, if you look at the Hebrew alphabet, the letter for the number 400 is the Tav. And if you look at the Paleo-Hebrew was a pictographical language, and so every word had a corresponding picture that went with it. And in the Paleo-Hebrew, Tav was represented by a sign, a signal, or a monument. And then here we find that particular number represented in the spacing in what God tells us are for signs, signals. And very, very interesting.
Yeah. Like I said, the world's gone nuts, and all those bad ideas are self-feeding. You be careful, Lua. Yeah, that's, you know, talking about not wanting to work on a rig, and I certainly don't want to go on one that's already on fire. I could think of lots of places I'd rather be than a burning oil rig in the middle of the ocean. Well, you know, I certainly don't advocate it, Dean, and you know, it certainly ain't good for me and all that sort of stuff. And you know, I know a lot of people worry about it being a sin, and since it's not good for me and stuff, it may be, but I don't know. But I don't think that that's the type of thing that God is looking to hold against me. I think that he's far more concerned with how I treat my brethren than the cigars I smoke. And I may be wrong, but that's just kind of where I'm coming from. Yeah, that's likely, John. You know, I've noticed, of course, you know, anybody that's been with me for a long time knows we went through a period there for a year or so where we had a lot of trouble getting through a single stream without some kind of interruption. But that has seemingly been alleviated over the last couple of years, and we've been rocking on pretty steady. But I have noticed a bit higher frequency of interruptions. You know, Dean, I know where you're coming from, and one of my mentors was a man that started chewing tobacco when he was 6 years old, and he chewed it until the day he died at almost 95. And he'd talk about tobacco from time to time, and his words were typically true, at least within his context. But he would say about tobacco that he said it's a lot of company. And I know you get what he meant, and I do too. You know what, David? I bet I've got that link that you mailed me. Hang on, I'll get it for you, Dale. Now, this will be the link from last night's live stream, Dale, but it'll certainly get you on the channel. And if that live stream's what you're looking for, then bingo, this is it. But here you go. Right, Dean. Not what goes into your mouth, but what comes out. Well, you know, and again about smoking, people think that it's the things they do or don't do that sends them to heaven or hell, and that's not exactly true. It's our belief and faith in Christ and our choice to follow Him. And our shortcomings are that. But yeah, certainly we're not free to go about sinning, you know, with abandon. And if we truly believe Christ and truly follow Him, then we wouldn't do those things anyway. And so
our behavior bears out what we believe, but it's not something that we can do or not do to save ourselves. You're welcome, Dale. You unleashed on those infidel monkeys. Okay. Well, we're glad that you're here with us, Dean. And you smoke cigars at the bonfire, Jess? I can see that. Wow, hour and a half. I hadn't heard from my mom yet. I guess I need to call her, but I don't know. It's probably cold outside. It was cold this morning when I got up. If she's got to drive over here with a window all the way down, I might better let it warm up a little bit. Typically, when I see women smoking cigars, it's generally big cigars, like, oh, who is it? Smoked those big things, Letterman or somebody. Anyway, well, you know, that's another thing. And I just recently, Pamela, heard a pastor talking about it, and I don't know why they do such things. But pastor was talking about Jesus drinking wine at the Last Supper. And claiming that new wine was non-alcoholic. Man gave that no thought whatsoever. Because let me tell you guys, y'all know that the Last Supper was it was a Passover Seder. So that puts it in when? The spring. Okay, when is the grape harvest? And when was the refrigerator invented? You know, guys, there was no way to preserve grape juice from the harvest in the fall all the way until the spring without fermenting it. And so the wine that Jesus drank was wine. And and like I said, I've heard so many pastors try to explain that away. Oh, it's new wine. That was just grape juice. Well, I'm pretty sure they know the difference between wine and grape juice. And the writers of the Bible would have been easily able to articulate that. Drinking, it's, you know, the Bible even tells us to drink a little wine for your stomach's sake. But what it warns about is overuse. That's where the sinning begins. And even more so, you guys all know that alcohol tends to lower people's inhibitions and a tendency to do something not right is greater when they're consuming alcohol. Sancho Panza, that sounds expensive. Yeah, I hear you, Dean. I don't drink at all. I say I don't drink at all. In the span of a year, I might consume 2 or 4 ounces of wine, not every year, and I just rarely ever drink. I just don't really care for it, but I know what you mean, brother. I grew up around a lot of very heavy drinkers. And flame-proof cigars. I wouldn't think that I have any allergy to it, and I used to drink a little bit when I was younger, but I just never saw it as a worthwhile endeavor, I suppose. And I've seen, well, myself included, but plenty of people act a total fool when they're drinking, and that's just not something that I want to do. It only took you 90 minutes, David. Well, I'm so proud. like I said, you know, drinking a little wine or a little whatever is not a sin. it's overusing it that Scripture warns us of, and with good reason. Yeah, matter of fact, Sue, my grandpa used to make liquor. He's dead now, so he can't get in trouble. But yeah, he used to make moonshine, and folks would come from a long way to buy his moonshine. He made apple and peach brandy that was country famous. Dandelion wine's pretty tasty. I have tried that, Jess. And two, I've had dandelion jelly too, which is pretty good. It's all right, Vicky. And two, you know, I doubt seriously my dad follows any of my live streams, and I wouldn't want to embarrass him, but gosh, you know, for years and years, he'd make a drink every day. I mean, as soon as the clock hit 5 o'clock, he'd make a drink. And I worried about him and his drinking for a long time. But I would say, and he's quit, he doesn't drink like that anymore. But I would say at the time he was an alcoholic, but I have never in my life seen a person be a functional alcoholic like he was. He ran a business he ran his company. He never drank during, you know, when he was working and all that sort of stuff. But you know, once the clock struck 5, he was drinking. And, like I said, I'm just concerned about him. Somebody said something to me about, you know, why don't you say something to him? And I said, well, you know, what can I say? I said, he's not messing up his life. He's not messing up anybody else's life. I said, you know, I've never seen somebody drink and maintain like that. But he did. God bless him. Apple pie. I don't think I've had apple pie moonshine, and I've got a little bit of moonshine that a guy gave me, David, that's supposed to be like cinnamon bun flavored or something like that. And I think I may have tasted it. I'll save you some. John Snyder has come out with a moonshine. I didn't know that, Janice. Good morning. Well, I need to wind this up here pretty quick. An hour and a half. Snyder Shine. Good morning, Janice. And yeah, like I said, there have been a few, Sue. And like I said, I was kind of astounded, but like I said, you know, there's never cause for me to say anything to him. Dean says, can we tell if another person has met Christ or been saved? I'm concerned about my dad. Well, Dean, you know, kind of what we were talking about earlier is, you know, and James says so. He said faith without works is dead. But, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean that you got to go out and adopt an orphan or provide a home for a homeless person or feed the hungry or anything like that. But what it's talking about is that the things that we do demonstrate what we believe. You know, for example, if you're standing in front of a fire, well, you're a pretty smart guy. I know that you would think, well, if I put my hand in that fire, it's going to burn me. So I'm not going to do that. I believe that fire will burn me, so I'm not going to put my hand in there. Now, on the other hand, if I didn't believe that fire would burn me, I might reach in there to see what a coal feels like. And you know, in that same vein, the things that we do betray what we believe, you know. I'll use it for an example, not necessarily a good one, but my partner and I, we used to run a little shop in town. We repaired mostly power equipment, lawnmowers, chainsaws, all that sort of stuff. But very, very often the street people, I guess, would come through trying to sell us something. And 99% of the time, if not 100% of the time, it was something stolen. And it may be a tool that we wanted or needed or whatever. And they want to sell it to us for $5. And we're like, yeah, that's a great price, but it's stolen. And so we wouldn't buy it. If you do, you know, if you buy something stolen from somebody, you might as well just go steal it yourself. And so, again, it's what we believe demonstrates, how we behave demonstrates what we believe. And so just subtly watch that behavior and you'll be able to make a pretty fair guess. You know what I mean? No, they don't get to heaven by works at all, Pamela, and I was certainly not asserting that, but what I was doing was trying to expound on what James said by saying faith without works is dead. And, you know, our works are the things that we do. And like I said, if we don't kill people, it's because we know we shouldn't. And we don't steal because we know we shouldn't. Like I said, it only demonstrates what we believe. It has nothing to do with our salvation. It only comes from Jesus Christ. He's the sole distributor of salvation. Amen. I'm not sure I know what you mean there, David, but I want to ask. Yeah, like I said, salvation is only available through Jesus. He bought it. He paid for it. It's his, and he can give and share it with whom he pleases. But we're talking about, what people believe. And the only way to truly, a person could tell you they believe anything. The only true way to ascertain what they believe is watch how they behave. Hey, Rick, good to see you, brother. Did you make me some coffee? Oh, yeah, I got you, David. And, of course, it don't just stop there, David. There are a lot of ways that we can implicate ourselves and do things that we shouldn't. And like I said, that's part of what demonstrates what we believe. Without believing that it's morally wrong, then buying bargain stolen stuff's a great deal. But we know that the ramifications are great. And not only does it provide, immediate gratification for the flesh, but it also provides some level of condemnation on ourselves because, we're throwing morals to the side in favor of gratifying our flesh. Right, yeah. Baptizing a cat's a four-handed proposition. And most people don't have but two. Oh, don't fall over, empty cup. David, won't you come over here and take my mother's window regulator off of her Hyundai Tucson? I've been looking at those doors on the internet. It's going to be a pain in the sitter. Fortunately, I can use the power screwdriver on most of it. Mm-hmm. All right, y'all tell me something. I don't know, what if I neglected to talk about something important? Jesus is coming. That's important. Oh, and nobody told me. I'm going to look, see if I can see what time the eclipse is supposed to happen. One more web page will probably shut me down here. time is the 2024 solar eclipse. Here's when you should look up in your area.
All right, then.
MSN page. It's going to take forever to load. Should have known better than to click it. Yeah, let's go back. Come on, you can do it. Shake it off. Monday, April 8th, the sky's most dramatic event occurs as the path of the total solar eclipse sweeps across the U.S. and the 2024 eclipse begins. At such times, the moon is directly between the sun and the earth. It casts its shadow on our planet. Because the sun is large, the moon's shadow has two parts. If you're under the outer, lighter shadow, called the penumbra, you will see a partial eclipse. But that's not the best place to see it. Ideally, your goal should be to stand beneath the moon's darker inner shadow, the umbra. That's where day will turn into night, where several planets will become visible, and where the corona, the sun's normally invisible outer atmosphere, will shine forth in all its glory. The moon's penumbra first touches Earth at 11:42 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time, and it last contacts it at 4:52 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. The total phase of the eclipse begins at 12:39 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, a bit more than 620 miles south of the Republic of Kiribati in the Pacific Ocean. The umbra remains in contact with Earth's surface for 3 hours, 16 minutes, and 45 seconds until 3:55 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, when it vanishes in the North Atlantic Ocean, 340 miles southwest of Ireland. The total length of the 2024 eclipse path is 9,190 miles. The magnitude of this eclipse is 1.0565, which means the moon's diameter is 5.65% larger than the sun's. Only when the magnitude is 1 or more will there be a total eclipse. Greatest eclipse occurs at 2:17 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, and the maximum length of totality anywhere on Earth is 4 minutes and 28 seconds. That point is just a few miles north of the small town of Nazas, Mexico. The time the eclipse occurs at any place varies across the United States. We also have to take into account the change in time zones from central to eastern. This table shows the times for a dozen cities that will experience totality. And I'll cruise over them, and I'm only going to give the time for totality in those places. Dallas, Texas is at 1:40 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Idabel, Oklahoma, 1:45 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Little Rock, Arkansas, 1:51. Poplar Bluff, Missouri, 1:56. Paducah, Kentucky, 2 p.m. Evansville, Indiana, 2:02 p.m. Cleveland, Ohio, 3:13 p.m. Eastern Time. Erie, Pennsylvania, 3:16 p.m. Eastern Time. Buffalo, New York, 3:18 p.m. Burlington, Vermont, 3:26 p.m. Lancaster, New Hampshire, 3:27 p.m. And Carabao, Maine is 3:32 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. So there you go. That's probably more than you wanted to know. And I was thinking the eclipse was going to occur when Miss Breeze gets off tomorrow, but she works late tomorrow, so that will not be the case. I'll have to remind her of that.